And welcome back, everyone. I'm Ed Bott, your host for today's Microsoft Virtual Academy Windows 8.1 Jumpstart. This is one of my favorite sessions that we're going to do right now on a topic that is near and dear to my heart. I've been writing about it for years, and that's security. I know a lot of people have misconceptions about security. They think, well, I've got antivirus software installed. I've got my security needs taken care of. It's a lot more complicated than that. And one of the interesting things about Windows 8.1, for a 0.1 release, you wouldn't think there'd be a lot of new stuff in there security related, but there is. And today, to help tell us all about it, we have Chris Hallam from the Windows commercial team, who is an expert on security, knows this stuff better than I do, and he's going to walk us through some of the really interesting new security features in Windows 8.1. Chris?
Great. Yeah, all right. Thanks for the introduction. So just for the audience, a little background on myself. Chris Hallam, obviously, from Windows commercial side of the business. So that's basically enterprise related side of the house. And my area is specifically security, obviously. And basically what that means, just to give kind of context, is it means any of the security technologies that are in Windows client operating system itself, those kind of fall under my domain. Security is a vastly large topic and includes things on the server side, things like PKI infrastructure, et cetera. I focus more on what's on the client side, which is large enough in its own. So
absolutely. So the threat landscape for security has changed a lot in the last 10 years. And I'm sure that you guys took that into account when you were designing the security infrastructure for Windows 8.1. What were the goals when you were building that framework, security framework for Windows 8.1?
Right. Well, it's funny what you said a few moments ago, that a lot of people think about security equals malware resistance, and it's far larger than that. And that is absolutely true. We have a lot of people talking about security only in terms of that. But when we look at our approach to security, it's a holistic approach. So our goals are to provide improvements for malware resistance, obviously, but also for data protection or information protection. And in addition, access control and authentication. So it's really those three key categories that we focus on. And we've done that for years. In fact, our model is virtually the same since as long as I can think about, because those are very high order bits. Something that is different though, when we moved on to Windows 8, is we've added another pillar, which is hardware. Typically in the past with things like XP and in Vista and even a little bit in 7, we really solved every single security problem that we had through software solutions. And when we moved into Windows 8, we knew that it was time to start binding our trust, not in software, which, you know, the reality is sometimes there's vulnerabilities and defects in software, right? But we want to bind our security at the lowest level, at the hardware itself, and to have hardware-rooted trust across a number of areas.
Yeah, so, you know, there's bad guys out there. We all know that there's bad guys out there. And one of the things that they've done is they figured out that there's this layer of software out there that's difficult to attack. So they have things like rootkits and bootkits that attack directly at the hardware level itself.
Exactly.
Right? So I've noticed that there's a whole new class of devices that are out there. There's tablets, there's notebooks, there's desktops, but they have a whole range of interesting new hardware features in them. Things like the trusted platform module, things like the getting rid of the traditional BIOS and replacing it with the UEFI firmware. So if I install Windows 8.1 on a system that I purchased in 2009 or 2010, I'll get the software layer protection. But what happens if I get a 2013 or 2014 model device with Windows 8.1 pre-installed on it? What's there?
Yeah, that's a great question, because it actually can be confusing. And so the good news is if you have a device from Windows 7, a Windows 7 certified device, when you install Windows 8 to it, you're going to have better security than you ever had with Windows 7 on that same hardware. However, if you want to go to the highest level of security that we offer on the Windows platform, you really need to be looking at new devices. And so with Windows 8, we've done a number of things. You mentioned a couple of the technologies, and I'll kind of briefly kind of go through them real quick. But one of the key technologies, one that we think is one of the most important, is a technology called Unified Extensible Firmware Interface. We also call it UFI or UEFI, depending on how you like to pronounce it. But this gives us a bunch of new capabilities. One is it's an architectural independent solution that replaces traditional BIOS, which, as you mentioned, is really old. In fact, BIOS is over 30 years old and really has not changed architecturally. And so it's way behind the times. And so,
I'm always startled when I see those 1980s copyrights in the BIOS screens on relatively new devices.
Yeah.
So the UEFI is, although it's not a brand new technology, but this is the first generation where it's really starting to appear in widespread. In fact, it's part of the certification requirement for a Windows 8.1 device, right? You have to have UEFI.
Yeah, absolutely. In fact, we think that the capability from a security perspective, a capability we call secure boot, which is part of the UEFI specification, that feature is so important that we don't believe PCs or any devices really should ship without this capability. And secure boot gives us the ability to address the boot kit scenario that you mentioned earlier, where a boot kit is able to inject itself maybe inside firmware or between the hardware and between the desired operating system. And in our world, that would be Windows, but it could be Linux or OS X or anything. And so the ability to have a secure handoff between the hardware, which is initialized by UEFI, and then securely start the trusted intended operating system, that was crucial. So we made that a certification requirement, because when you have a boot kit on your PC, Windows will never know it, your anti-malware solution will never know it, and this will go undetected probably indefinitely in most cases, especially in the consumer side.
So the way that this works is I turn on my PC, and it goes through the boot up process. And I may or may not see logos and text messages flashing across the screen, but eventually then it hands it over to Windows, which then begins loading the operating system and displaying my desktop. And by the way, on this new generation of hardware, that happens amazingly fast. I've got one device here that I can go from a cold start with UEFI, and 10 seconds later, I'm up and running, and that's one of the forget about security. That's one of the big advantages of UEFI is boom, instant on. But if somebody has snuck in there and they've fooled me at some point into running something as an administrator that I shouldn't have run, and they tried to get down there in the previous generation, they could have modified the startup files for the entire system, and at that point they own my box. They've taken me over. So now with secure boot, let's say I do that and it tries to write something to the firmware that's going to take over my machine. What happens?
Well, the good news is all firmware and option ROMs on these Windows 8 certified devices require signed firmware. So malware would actually have to be signed by the signature that's used by the OEM or the vendor of the particular device. So they need to actually compromise those signatures. And of course, that's difficult. So to answer your question directly is, unless they've signed themselves with somebody else's signature, which is very difficult to do, they cannot even embed themselves in hardware anymore.
Okay, so the more likely scenario then is that they've managed to find some boot critical driver. And they've managed to get me to install some driver that comes in at a very low level of the system, and it has some malware in it that's going to take over my file system or video subsystem or somewhere, and they're going to use that to try and infiltrate into the system. So now, can they do that?
Well, actually, we have another feature that addresses that concern. So we've kind of divided our boot protection into two distinct pieces. First is to protect the initialization of an operating system. And so UEFI's secure boot basically all but guarantees, because we can't guarantee anything in security, but it basically gives us a high level of assurance that, Windows, in the Windows case, is going to start first. But from there, then there's other places they attack. For instance, you know, we've been talking about bootkit so far. The rootkit, maybe that malicious driver as you're talking about, will maybe attempt to embed itself, and traditionally in the past, on Windows 7 previous operating systems, they would embed themselves as a kernel mode driver, and they would own the entire operating system. In fact, what they typically would do is try to insert that driver and have it start very early in the process. Have it start before Windows defenses have even started, core Windows drivers potentially, and your anti-malware solutions as well. And so basically the lower you can start in the stack, the more likely you're able to cause harm and persist over time. And so we have a feature in Windows 8, and it's also there, of course, in 8.1 called Trusted Boot. And Trusted Boot basically gives us a complete lockdown of the entire boot process, almost up to the Windows sign-in. So basically all the Windows defenses are going to start, all of Windows are going to start, the anti-malware solution is going to start before any other third-party software. And just to be really clear there, that the first third-party software that would be able to start would be potentially an anti-malware solution. They have a special socket.
So that's the early launch anti-malware.
Absolutely.
ELAM.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That could be a Microsoft, that could be Windows Defender, which is built into Windows 8.1, or it could be Forefront, is that the...
Forefront Endpoint Management,
sure. Which is the Microsoft solution, or it could be a third-party, because third-party trusted antivirus vendors can have their solution signed and registered so that it can run as an early launch anti-malware solution, right?
Absolutely. In fact, you mentioned the key feature of ELAM. So our early load anti-malware solution, basically the third party is able to design their driver based on a specification that we've put in the SDK. Then when they've built it, they submit the driver to us. We then sign it with a signature that our trusted boot process trusts, and that's what enables a trusted third-party anti-malware solution from starting versus maybe a malicious anti-malware solution that's maybe impersonating the anti-malware solution itself.
Okay, so now we, Chris and I had a chance to talk while I was researching, I'm going to give a plug for this book, Introducing Windows 8.1 for IT Professionals. It's the electronic version of it in PDF, EPUB, and MOBI formats is free, and the link will be available at various times during today's festivities. This printed version is also available. It costs a few dollars, but we talked about security at some length in this, and this really, some of this stuff was just absolutely fascinating to me, because this just, I mean, it renders a lot of these threats virtually impossible. A lot of the tricks that the bad guys have been using for years just don't work anymore, right?
Absolutely. In fact, you know, we talked about boot root and rootkits, right? Well, UFI is the answer to bootkits, and Trusted Boot is the answer to rootkits. And effectively, they've been all but eradicated from the threat landscape with those technologies. So you're right. We take a very purposeful approach to trying to eliminate entire classifications of malware, not through more defenses and just making it harder, but through architectural solutions that really make eliminate the possibility for them in the first place.
Okay, so now we've talked about malware, we've talked about the idea that someone wants to take over your system, but in a lot of cases, the threat doesn't necessarily come from malicious code. Rather, it comes from social engineering, somebody trying to steal your identity. We think of identity theft as a consumer thing, but in an enterprise space, there are a lot of targeted attacks that people are doing where they'll try and get you to hand over your credentials to them so that they can impersonate you, and then at that point, if they can impersonate you, they have access to your network, they have access to your data files, they have access to your email so that they can then socially engineer your colleagues by sending them malicious attachments and so forth. So the whole notion of identity protection is also an important thing to be considering as we head into as we're well into the 21st century now. So what are the things that we can look at in Windows 8.1 that have to do with that?
Right. Great question. So In Windows 8, if we step back, our main goal, our top priority from a security perspective was to address the threats of malware. And so we did UFI, we did Trusted, but we did a long list of other things to make the system more resistant to malware than it's ever been. But in 8.1, the hero of investment became what we call access control and authentication. And so with that, we wanted to make sure that stronger forms of authentication, stronger authenticators, such as maybe a biometric identity, for instance, even making passwords even to in some respects more secure than they have been in the past, that we wanted to provide a range of options that could make those identities more secure. When it comes to phishing attacks and trying to use social engineering attacks to steal identities or dupe people into doing things, we've made big investments in technologies like Smart Screen, which is part of Windows, but also part of IE. The blending of those two kind of work together. But in the case of phishing attacks, for instance, Internet Explorer 11 provides effectively leading edge anti-phishing protection. In fact, NSS Labs, which does analysis of anti-malware solutions as well as phishing types of solutions, rated us as one of the top last year. I think they have a recent report as well. But we do basically top-notch work when it comes to protecting users while they're online away from malicious websites and malicious applications that they may be tricked into to downloading and installing.
So that's a lot of those phishing attacks are designed to get my password.
Yep.
And we know. I actually know there's a guy named Matt Honan who. Hi, Matt. Who works for Wired magazine. Matt and I have known each other for a long time, and he had he wrote in Wired magazine last year about a nightmare experience that he had where someone, and they were apparently just vandals, but they stole his identity, mm-hmm. and got his password and proceeded to make a mess of his life for a while. Now, Matt like me is a writer, so it. They made a mess of his personal devices, but fortunately there wasn't a lot of impact on the enterprise. Had that happened to somebody who's an employee of, say, a defense contractor or a health insurance provider, or some sort of global financial institution, that sort of scenario is an absolute nightmare. So how do you move beyond the password? So that not only someone's identity is protected, but the organization that person works for has their data and their corporate secrets protected from an attacker.
Yeah, so it's interesting in that passwords have been part of our lives as far back as we can go, right? They've been around for over 30 years, maybe hundreds of years. There have been some sort of secrets and password-like types of things that people have used.
Right. Louis sent me.
Yeah, exactly. And so, as Matt mentioned, passwords are just no longer good enough, and we totally agree. The challenge, though, is passwords are deeply embedded in our style of using computers, in our IT infrastructure, and so we can't turn a switch and say we've got a new solution and everybody can use it. So we have a strategy. It takes several steps to get rid of passwords, and with Windows 8, we took what I think was a very important step. For organizations, and that step is to help customers move away from passwords to a stronger form, a two-factor form that uses a certificate as the identity rather than a password, right. And then a second factor like a physical smart card is the second factor. And so the challenge with multi-factor authentication in the past has been the fact that one factor is something and the second factor has been something you have. And so with a physical smart card, for instance, that something you have might be something you also forget, right? You may leave that at home. Maybe you access the corporate network from home and use your smart card to do that, and you run off to work and you've left the card. And now you can't get into the office. Maybe like here at Microsoft, we can't buy our lunch without our smart cards. So there's a lot of impact. In fact, that impact from a productivity perspective is very expensive, because if I can't get into the building and I can't buy my lunch, I'm not as productive as I can be. In fact, I might not be able to do my job at all. And so because of this, what we found is organizations always want two factors of authentication, but they usually don't deploy it, or they only deploy it in subsets of their organization because they're worried about people forgetting it and maybe not having easy access to recovering it, et cetera. So our goal with Windows 8.1 was to try to lift some of those burdens. Let's try to drive the cost of two-factor authentication down as much as possible, and let's try to avoid that challenge where somebody might leave the second factor somewhere else and not be able to get their job done. And so we do that with a technology that we call virtual smart cards. And so virtual smart cards, like a physical smart card, are basically a digital identity that's a certificate that represents you. In the case of a physical smart card, there's the chip on the card itself that protects it. That chip has anti-hammering capabilities to prevent people from tampering with the chip and trying to extract and export that identity. And in the case of virtual smart cards, we actually leverage the trusted platform module that you mentioned earlier as effectively like the smart card chip. The TPM itself binds that identity to the PC. It prevents it from being exported. And now the PC itself is your second factor of authentication. So you now have something that you know, and you have something that you have, something that you probably won't forget at home, or is at least as easily as you would maybe leave a smart card around.
Right. So if you left your notebook or tablet or device at home, you weren't going to get much work done today anyway, because that's where that's where all your work is embedded. So virtual smart card is one of the things I was really fascinated to learn about when I was researching this book, and it's tied in most cases to that trusted platform module, right?
Absolutely.
So the TPM. Stop me at any point if I get this wrong, but the TPM is a chip that's in there, and it is a secure cryptographic store and processing unit, so it can handle secrets, and can't be tampered with. So the idea is, if at some point there has to be a registration process that turns that TPM into a virtual smart card for me.
Correct.
Right? So tell us how that works.
Right. So as you mentioned, the TPM is that security crypto processor. And so we use that to bind the identity to the PC and make it non-exportable. And so when it comes to an identity, the threat that we need to address is we need to make sure that identity can't be moved to another device or can't be transferred over the internet. So when that provisioning of that identity to the device occurs, we want to lock it there and make sure that it stays there in a secure way. And so the TPM gives us that, just like the chip on the smart card gave us that on the physical smart card. Right. When it comes to the provisioning of it, there's a number of companies that work with us. We have an API layer in Windows that allows a management system such as Intercede's My ID as an example, or our own solution, System Center Identity Manager, has the ability to provision that certificate. So the basic experience would be, in the case of FIM, which is the Microsoft solution, the user would go to a website, follow some instructions to provision the certificate, and then the server would provision that identity and then bind that identity to the device. And at that point, the user experience for using a virtual smart card is actually identical to a physical smart card. The difference is the user with a physical smart card will be inserting that physical smart card into the device, which, by the way, is problematic on a tablet, right? Because we don't have smart card readers on these. And this is one of the reasons why we did this for Windows 8 is if we move to tablets, we need better forms of two-factor authentication. But the device itself is the smart card. It's the smart card reader. And the card itself, they're always inserted, always ready to go, but the end user's experience is the same, and the provisioning experience from an IT perspective is identical as well. So this is a great solution in that we didn't come up with another model altogether that has a whole new set of challenges. We leveraged all the infrastructures already there and basically virtualized the smart card with this technology.
So basically, if a bad guy who's maybe thousands of miles away from me is able to successfully convince me to give him my username and password, that's not going to be very helpful, because that username and password will only work on this device that has the virtual smart card.
Exactly.
He tries to use that on his own tablet or PC or whatever he's got, and just going to say, sorry, buddy, you're out of luck. It's not going to work. So there's two factors involved there, but as far as the user experience goes, I don't even realize that this is part of my that this is my second factor.
Exactly. Yeah. So this idea that somebody could phish your identity and then remotely leverage it goes away completely. Because now they need to steal the credential, the PIN in the case of a smart card, and then they also have to take your device. And that's going to be hard to do from a far away place.
Considerably harder to do.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact. Now, the other interesting option that we have for two-factor authentication is biometrics.
Absolutely.
I mean, we're all used to seeing science fiction novels where someone looks into an eyeball scanner and it reads their retina. But the fingerprint is great. I mean, my fingerprint is unique.
Absolutely.
And it identifies me uniquely. That plus a password is another form of two-factor authentication, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Yeah.
So I've been using, I remember I had a Windows PC in 2002 that had a fingerprint reader on it. You guys have been doing fingerprint technology for a long time. Are today's fingerprint readers on a Windows 8.1 device, are those secure enough, accurate enough to be used as a second factor in a two-factor authentication system?
Well, I mean, the answer is they can be. And it really, you need to be kind of careful about the technology that you're looking at. And we're doing a lot of work with a group of people who we think are doing exceptional work when it comes to fingerprint-based biometrics to make sure that some of the attack vectors that we would want to worry about, things like fake fingerprints, people who maybe molded a fingerprint, made it very realistic. We want to make sure that those devices, the ones that we're going to endorse and the companies that we're going to put some of our muscle behind with them and partner with them, that they do good work there. And so it's kind of interesting, just a couple months ago, of course, Apple released the iPhone 5S and they released a touch-based sensor. Touch-based sensors are great, and you're probably familiar with the swipe-based sensors that we've seen where you swipe your finger across a kind of a thin surface. It's usually about 3 millimeters one direction and about 9 the other, so it's a kind of a narrow little thing, and you swipe your finger. It takes a little agility to get it to work. If you're sitting in an odd angle, you might not get it, so it generally takes a couple tries for people to use those sensors. The touch sensors are superior. You can touch these in less than a second. You can touch the surface, and it's able to read your fingerprint accurately, and then sign you in or do whatever. But to bring it back to the Apple scenario, is they had this great touch sensor. In fact, it was based on great technology from a company called Authentech. We're very familiar with them because they've been producing sensors for Windows devices forever, and of course, they were later on acquired by Apple. The attack that we saw, you've probably seen the video, maybe you've watched it yourself, I'm sure many of the people watching.
I wrote about it, actually.
Did you write about it?
Okay. At CDNet, yeah.
Okay, well, maybe I'm preaching to the choir on this. It looks really simple, the attack. But the reality is that required a lot of control. And the control that was required to make that work was these people use their own fingerprint, right? So if I have control of my own fingerprint, I want to hijack or break into my own device with a fake version of that, I might be able to take the time and be able to use the tools necessary to create a three-dimensional print that has the level of fidelity required to maybe get through these sensors. If you're worried about that scenario, which is the hacker hacking their own device, then maybe this technology isn't for you.
Maybe you need three-factor authentication.
Maybe so, yeah.
If your secrets are that valuable.
Exactly. And so if we look at the scenario, which is the one we're really worried about, which is where my fingerprint was left on the device, maybe it's left on the phone or it's left on my tablet, and if we're worried about somebody lifting that and then recreating a print with three dimensions of fidelity and high resolution and the ability to trick a sensor, which has a concept that we call liveness, the ability to detect whether the thing on the surface of the sensor, is it something that's alive or something that's not? Mm-hmm. Is it rubber?
Right.
When you bring these three dimensions together, three dimensions, high fidelity resolution, and liveness detection, we think that the ability for somebody to lift something off of glass or some surface and recreate that in a way that can dupe the sensors that we're working, that we're interested in, that we're working with partners on, that's going to be pretty tough to to pull off. And so, you know, we don't know all the details on exactly the Apple thing. They need to speak on that themselves. But we know enough about what's going on there to say that that's not a trivial attack vector. And we know that we're working with people who are, we think, can maybe bring it to the next level. So I feel very secure about where we're going with the technology sensors. The sensors that you have in today's devices, Lenovo is an example that ships swipe sensors regularly. Those are high quality, very good. The touch sensors for the Windows platform are going to be available in H2 of 2014. So we expect to see those showing up on tablets, maybe other form factors as well next year.
Great. And there's and one thing that's always important to keep in mind when you're talking about security, there's a trade-off between security and convenience, and depending on what the value of the secrets you're trying to protect is how much difficulty, how much inconvenience you want to impose on the user. So one of the things that I remember you telling me about is that the fingerprint technology that's in Windows 8.1 is not just for authentication. You can do other things with it as well, right?
Absolutely. And this is one of the key differentiators we have in 8.1 with our biometrics technology. There's a couple things that we added, right? We added authentication, right? That's the obvious one. That's where I'm able to sign into my device, my VPN, or other resources on the network using my biometric identity. But we think that biometrics is useful for two additional scenarios. One is related to consent. So when I go up to the Windows Store and I want to make a purchase of an application, the experience that we've had in the past is the store asks you to provide a password, this thing that we don't think is really that secure in today's world. And so what would happen is people would use their password, and it would impede them in the progress of making that purchase. And because of customer feedback, we had a little checkbox at the bottom, you might remember, which said, just don't ask me about my password again. If I'm signed into my device and I'm at the store, I think that's good enough. Go ahead and make the purchase. But we think that with biometrics and the convenience of it, that we can add this consent and also authentication factor for the purchase itself that doesn't impede the purchasing process, that doesn't get in a way, heightens the sense of security for the end user, and doesn't frustrate them in the process. So when you use a touch sensor, for instance, when you're going to the Windows Store or Xbox Music and Video, you can use your biometric sensor to confirm and provide consent to the purchase, which is great too, because then it gives you provable audit trail that, you know, that actually was Ed that made that purchase and not a hacker who may have broken into their system or your system.
Right. So. I actually have a fingerprint reader on my desktop at home. I use it.
Okay, great.
I use it all the time. And one of the things that I was really pleased to see in Windows 8.1 was the standard user interface that you've got before, that you have now, that matches the rest of the Windows user interface. Before, it was the third party, the manufacturer of the sensor, contracted or hired their own programmers to build a user interface for it. And so you had this sometimes disjointed experience with authenticating using a fingerprint, and now that's integrated into the operating system. So number one, it was really easy to set up. Just sort of, I plugged it in and it started working. And number two, things like enrolling my fingerprint, it all felt like part of Windows, not like a third-party thing that had been added in. So you've done that too, right?
Absolutely. In fact, it's just like you said. I mean, the fact that you had to go to a third party to get the middleware to actually complete the biometric experience on Windows and previous versions was a challenge. In fact, there are tens and tens of millions of devices with these swipe sensors out there, and I can't imagine how people are actually using them. It's probably maybe not in the millions.
And you're right. Maybe they're not because there is that barrier. People just say, install software, do all this configuration. I'll just use my password.
Exactly.
Instead.
And so they end up getting this software that's kind of foreign and unfamiliar, et cetera. And so they end up not using it. So we included a enrollment experience that works across all of the sensors that are out there. There's some requirements that the drivers have to accommodate to, but that's well published in the SDK. And so whether you're using a swipe sensor or whether you're using one of these new touch sensors, our enrollment experience works across both of those types, and also regardless of vendor. So it's common no matter what. And guess what? It's also in the box now. So in fact, when I set up my Lenovo X1 Carbon, the drivers automatically got downloaded from from the Windows update, and my sensor was ready to go. I didn't have to do anything. So it really encouraged use of this great technology that, to be honest, I'd been ignoring on previous versions of Windows. And there's one scenario you asked about, what are the three key scenarios for biometrics? We had authentication, and then we talked about consent. One that I think is really going to excite the audience, I want to make sure we talk about it, is the ability to gate activity based on verification or maybe re-verification that the user is present. So today what happens is when you sign into your PC and you run off to lunch in a hurry and you fail to lock your device, anybody who walks up to that device is going to be you. Right? They can load any application. They can get any data that you have access to.
I understand that happens at Microsoft occasionally. If you walk away and leave your machine unlocked.
Not in my office. but at any rate, so we have all this sensitive information out there that's really susceptible to just human error. Right, yeah. And so what we thought, and this is, I think, a differentiator of the Microsoft platform versus other people who are investing in biometrics on their operating systems, is we have this rich SDK that allows people to adopt biometrics to gate access to applications or maybe actions within applications based on their biometric identity. So just to make that sound real, imagine your banking app. Right. Today, you load it up, you do your banking, and you close the app. Well, imagine if the developer for that banking app integrated biometrics. They could prevent the startup of the app based on re-verification that you're actually still present in the device. And the beauty there is that's a very frictionless experience, right? To touch, to verify, to load that app doesn't really impede progress. And again, you get that heightened sense of security, so it doesn't frustrate you from a user perspective. So that's one thing, we can gate applications, but then we can also gate actions within an application. So your bank may feel, it's okay if somebody loads the banking app, because maybe the front page of that app is all marketing material, right? It's not anything confidential about you, it's just services they provide, et cetera. But maybe when you drill into your account with an application and try to access information like account balances or maybe make banking transfers, then they can use our API to hook that and say, well, if you're gonna drill down into the account page, then you need to verify that you're there. And so this is really powerful for banking scenarios. It's gonna be great in healthcare. We have a lot of interest in the healthcare industry because patient records and confidentiality is absolutely critical.
Any kind of regulated industry where the costs of having a data breach are high.
Is a place
where you need that. Yeah. You mentioned banking, and we're all used to doing secure transactions with banks and financial institutions and shopping sites and everything over the internet, and those all use certificates, public key infrastructure, right? PKI stuff. You've made a bunch of investments in PKI infrastructure in Windows 8.1 as well, right?
Yeah, we've done a couple of interesting things. One scenario that's not specific to banking, it's, I think, to help the PKI infrastructure on the web, is a feature that we call certificate reputation. And so to help the audience understand the relevance of certificate reputation, let's talk about the problem. The problem with PKI is it's all based on an assumption. And that assumption is that the identities that you have never been compromised. And so we know there are very famous compromises of identities, not only of users, but also of institutions. There is a company in Europe who's a certificate authority, right? So they're the people who generate and provision certificates. They were tricked into issuing the certificates for some well-known companies, very, very large companies. And from there, the attackers were able to set up fake websites that looked like those companies' websites, and then they were able to redirect people to those sites, and at that point they were then stealing their identities, etc. So the challenge is once the certificates, the identities are no longer secure, PKI breaks down. It's no longer trustworthy. And so what we've done is we've added this feature called certificate reputation out there on the web. Basically, it's a cloud service that we have, and what we're doing is we're actually taking a look at all the public certs that are being passed around between major sites and users, and we're going and getting those ourselves. We're finding out where they're being provisioned from, and we're doing deep analysis of the certificates themselves. We're able to determine, well, what algorithm was used to create this certificate, what are the properties on this certificate. So we get all this rich information about it. And then by storing this information and then maybe searching the web again tomorrow, we can start to see maybe anomalies in these certificates. So for instance, if somebody fabricated a certificate. So in other words, they recreated it using some new computer science, for instance. They're able to create a Microsoft certificate. This service, once it collected that certificate, would be able to actually analyze and see this was not generated using the same process ours were created. It was actually created fraudulently. And so from there, we could initiate a certificate revocation process that would basically disable that certificate. So cert rep is interesting in that we're basically trolling the web, basically it's a web crawler, basically collecting all these certificates, doing deep analysis, looking at the certificates from yesterday versus the ones that are being issued today. We're looking within them. We're also looking where they're being provisioned from. If there's a data center in a country issuing certificates for Microsoft, and we know that we don't have servers there, we're going to know right away.
There's some alarms that are going to go off in a building here in Redmond.
Yeah, they're going to be very loud, and we're going to take quick action. And the key thing, the key takeaways is this is not just for Microsoft properties. This is for any of the top 1 million websites, our friends, our competitors, et cetera. We're working right together to try to add trust to the PKI infrastructure. This is also not specific to Windows 8 devices. This benefits actually any device that's using certificates, actually. So it's kind of that's how much we believe in security here.
So I want to move on to a topic that's also really important in terms of security, and that's information protection. So I have, this little device here, a little 8-inch Windows 8.1 tablet. It's brand new, and I really like it. And so, I'm very conscious of it, and I'm not likely to lose it because it's new and valuable to me. But after this becomes second nature, there's a risk that I'm going to sit down in a cab, drive somewhere, and it's going to fall out of my briefcase, and I'm going to leave it behind in the cab, or I'm going to leave it in the seat pocket of my, of the airplane that I'm in or somewhere. And, or worse, that somebody who wants to target me is going to steal this device, and then they're going to try to get the secrets off of it. So the obvious solution, if I have information on there that I don't want a stranger to have, is encryption. Right? So in the past, most of the IT pros in this audience are familiar with BitLocker technology, which was available. It's primarily a corporate feature. But in Windows 8.1, device and disk encryption has been expanded greatly over just that sort of narrow BitLocker scenario, right? Can you tell us about that?
Absolutely. So in the past, as you said, we've had this BitLocker technology, which provides military-grade encryption capability for professional and the enterprise editions of Windows. But when we look at the threat landscape today, and we look at BYOD, and we look at how people are continue to put more and more of their personal confidential information on devices, we believe that it was time to move encryption down into all editions of Windows. And so we have a version of BitLocker. We call it device encryption. And device encryption is on Windows Phone 8. It's also on Windows RT. And device encryption is a great technology for a couple reasons. One, it's based on BitLocker. So it's military grade, got that military grade encryption capability. But the difference is device encryption is automatically provisioned to the PC. So when you get your Windows Phone 8 device or you get your Windows RT device, it already has the encryption provision. It's already there. I don't even need to think about it. It's just already there. The only thing I really need to do is sign in with a Microsoft account because we want to make sure that if anything bad ever happens to the PC, it gets damaged or there's disk corruption, that we can recover the data off the disk. And so when you sign in with your MSA, we add the protection, in effect, turning the encryption protectors on, and we put those keys in the cloud with your Microsoft account. So if the disk gets corrupted, you can get those keys, and they can go hopefully get reclaim some of your data. So that's a great feature.
I actually had that happen to me the other day. I was doing some stuff with a Surface 2. And it popped up a thing and it said, this device is BitLocker encrypted and you need to enter your recovery key now, which is is that 40 numbers or so?
48 digits.
48 digits. Yeah. And I thought, what am I going to do here? And then I looked at the text underneath and it said, go to windows.microsoft.com/recovery-key.
Yeah.
And so I went there, signed in with my Microsoft account, and there was the 48-digit code for the device. It took me about 30 seconds to carefully typed that in, and I was back in business. I never specifically or deliberately backed that key up. It was just done for me, and so that's just from a consumer and end user in the enterprise perspective. That was a really good experience, and that was because otherwise, had I not had that recovery key, would have been time to reformat the device and say goodbye to whatever data was on it.
Absolutely, yeah. Right? You're never getting in, in theory, with that 48-digit key
getting in your way. My supercomputer is offline, so I don't think I'm going to be cracking any of that BitLocker encryption.
Yeah.
But so in addition, so you've got full device encryption on any modern device.
Yeah. So we've this device encryption, which was just in Windows Phone and RT, with Windows 8, we pushed it into every edition of Windows. And in fact, it's even on enterprise and professional. And so what IT is going to benefit from this greatly, because now when these devices are provisioned, right, the encryption will already be there, and then they can just simply start managing it with BitLocker management.
So BitLocker adds, so the encryption is there across the board on new Windows 8.1 devices. BitLocker adds, it's a higher grade of encryption, higher bit level of encryption, but more importantly, its manageability, right?
Correct. Yeah. In fact, that's typically how I position it. Is device encryption virtually the same between the two. You can go to a higher level of encryption if you want to go to 256. You can use BitLocker to do that. 128 generally will satisfy most customers. So the real value for most customers is the ability to manage it at a corporate level. Most organizations will want to basically centrally harvest the keys so that they can do centralized recovery. But maybe more importantly, for regulation reasons, they may want to be able to centrally report on the status of a device. In healthcare, for instance, if you lose a device and it has any patient information on it, you actually have to report out to the government and actually the customers as well if that data was not encrypted. And so the reports are a key piece of evidence that you can use to maybe not have to do that disclosure.
That's that sinking feeling that somebody in the healthcare industry gets in their stomach if somebody's device was stolen. That's not a good thing to have happen. Now, the other interesting scenario for information protection is I've lost my device. It might have my passwords. It might have my banking details on it, my bank statements on it, all sorts of information that I really don't want to lose. But there's the flip side of that is if I'm an employee and I leave the company and I have this device, or if I'm a contractor and I'm working for you temporarily and you've given me some files that I need access to and then the contract ends, there might be secrets that are in those files as well that you want management over. So what's the story with those scenarios?
Right. So with Windows 8.1, one of the key things we want to do is improve the bring your own device scenario that we had on Windows. And so a lot of the investments are in the management side, but some of them are on the security side, as you just alluded to. And so what corporations need is when you have a bring your own device type of scenario where a person's bringing their personal device in and they're getting provisioned corporate data to that device. When the relationship ends, that corporation wants to not just know that the device itself was encrypted with BitLocker, they probably want to wipe the data off the device as well. And so we have a feature in 8.1 called Remote Business Data Removal. It's basically a selective wipe capability. And this feature is able to differentiate between the corporate data that was provisioned to the PC and all of the user's data. And so what we do is we leverage a technology that's been around for many versions of Windows called Encrypting File System, or EFS. Mm-hmm. And so we leverage that EFS technology to do file-level encryption. So as you receive email, for instance, from Exchange, the container that the email lives in will be encrypted with EFS. A key will be generated and stored in the Windows credential locker. And then when the relationship ends with this user, they can initiate the wipe command using EAS or maybe Intune or an MDM like Mobile Iron, I believe, will be adopting this, and AirWatch as well, I believe. But that you can initiate the command, and then that command, whether you're corporate connected or on the internet, is issued to the device. The key is then deleted off the device, and then the file itself will be deleted as well in the case of email. And so you basically have a content that can never be recovered Even if you use tools from like, let's say Dart, for instance, which is a desktop management tool set for recovery, you might be, you would be able to recover the file, but it's encrypted.
Yeah.
And so you would never be able to access it because the keys are destroyed.
So I'd get a string of letters and numbers, but without the key, there's no way to decrypt that.
Exactly.
More importantly, that was my personal device. You never had to make this a fully managed device. And you don't have to wipe all of my personal files from it. You can just say, you know, that file's here, and here. You don't need any more, and we're going to take them away. But all the rest of my files, all the rest of my data are intact and untampered with.
Yep, exactly. And actually, the feature gets even a little better than that. Doesn't just wipe the mail file. One of the problems we've had with mail in the past is, well, what happens when somebody saves those attachments onto the file system? Well, traditionally, IT loses control of those files, right? They've escaped the container effectively. We can allow those files to escape the container, but we also keep them encrypted and wipeable as well. So whether you've got attachments being saved all over the file system or whether it's sitting there in the original mail container, that OST file or whatever it is on the file system, we're able to get those files and wipe them. Another scenario we're able to do is with a feature called work folders. So with Server 2012 R2, there's a feature called work folders, which is a file replication service. You're able to basically, join this service, receive corporate data, and this data is also selectively wipeable with our remote business data removal tools as well.
We're going to get a demo later today of the work folders and workplace join features, so everyone will get a chance to see that one, which is pretty cool stuff. And again, this is for those scenarios where you have devices that either can't be joined to the domain, or they're personal devices where the owner of the device doesn't want them to be joined to the domain. So you get some management control over them without having to fully manage them. So that's pretty cool. Now there's one more new feature that I want to talk about. We only have about 2 minutes left, but there's one more new feature that you've mentioned, which is a malware protection feature, and it's a new web service that allows for you to attest to the fact that I booted properly. Can you tell me what that feature is and how it works?
Yeah, absolutely. So we have a great new feature called it's got an interesting name. It's called Provable PC Health. So the name might need some work, but it's a
Provable PC Health.
Yes, exactly. Okay. So a little bit of a mouthful, but it's a great feature. And so the challenge we're trying to address with this is, it kind of goes back to our PKI conversation, right? When we talk about UEFI Secure Boot and Trusted Boot, that's all based on the assumption that the signatures that are used on those files have never been compromised. But they could be one day. And so we want to make sure that Windows has a countermeasure for that, that we can trust but verify the system. And the way we do verification is not local, right? When a system is compromised at kind of a root level, there's nothing local that's going to be able to detect that. So with Provable PC Health, what we have is a cloud-based service that's able to remotely analyze the health of the PC. And we leverage a feature called Measure Boot that leverages the Trusted Platform Module. So the Trusted Platform Module is able to take measurements. And so as the PC is booting, the Measured Boot is taking measurements of the UEFI firmware, Option ROM firmware, the Windows OS loader, the Windows kernel, drivers, the anti-malware solution. All of these key things are central to the base security of the system are measured. So we have basically a series of hashes about those. Mm-hmm. And then at that point, Measure Boot kind of stops, right? It's basically taking the measurements and then storing them and protecting them with the TPM so that they can't be protected. Provable PC Health is able to receive that data from the client and then is able to analyze that data. And guess what? We have a cloud in the database, or excuse me, we have a database in the cloud that has a list of all the hashes from every known Windows OS loader, every known anti-malware solution driver that we've ever signed. All of this data is sitting in the cloud. And so when we see new measurements come in, if they do not compare against known good values, we know that there's something very serious on the PC. And we're talking about viruses and malware that are on the extreme side of bad, right? These are not typical malware. This is some of the worst malware. And so Provable PC Health is about being able to trust, but then verify remotely. using a cloud service. And we're talking about the worst type of malware, the malware you would never want to have.
And so when the web service sees that something like this has happened, you can notify the user and say, this needs to get fixed now. If it's on a corporate, if it's on the enterprise side, you can say, you know, you need to contact the help desk because we're not going to let you into the network until this is fixed.
Well, that's basically true, but one real nuance to that is it's designed to inform the user, maybe through text or email or as they're using the PC, they can find out that there's some challenge, and then we provide remediation steps. Those remediation steps may mean go use Defender offline and clean up the malware. There could be a lot of different things you can do. We can also find out, based on the nature of the thing we've detected, we know that that's a keylogger that's on your PC.
Right.
We know that your accounts probably are compromised, and we can recommend that you reset your accounts on LinkedIn or Facebook or whatever, and we can then force a reset of the Microsoft account as well through that system. The one little nuance, based on what you said, is that the system is designed kind of for consumers right now, and so we're looking in the future to improve it with an enterprise reporting capability, potentially. We're taking feedback from customers so that the corporation could get that notification rather than just the end user. But right now, kind of designed for BYOD scenarios.
Okay, great.
Perfect.
Chris, thanks so much. This has been an enlightening session. We're going to take a meal break right now, and we will be back at the top of the hour. And when we are, we'll be talking about management and mobility and deployment. So thanks, everyone.
Thank you.